Just you see that girl over in the corner, bro?
She got it. Jay Will.
You gotta lock eyes with her.
She got it. Throw some D on it, boy.
I know the Millennium Tour just kicked off, but goddamn, we gonna play something from our days in the student union parties. Goddamn it, Two Pistols. I don't know where he been at, but she got it. Happy Women's Month, International Women's Day.
Whatever they celebrate. A few days ago. Shout out to the Midwest Eclectic. You feel me?
Midwest Eclectic. Oh, that just sound like a nice group. Who is that?
Who is that? Man, that's the Nautons, man. That's they shot, B.
That's right. Yeah. Shout out to the Midwest Eclectics.
Shop Etsy, man. Etsy.com/shop/seeper1972.
We started the show off just right into it last week. I don't even remember introducing the show, so I'm going to make sure I actually do that today. Welcome back to the ITO podcast. I go by the name Johnny Will.
It's the next one, Nick.
Cartier King. I always cash in it.
And we are from the state of Ohio, and today we had our first 68-degree weather day, and I knew it was hot because I'm riding the streets, and everybody, they had the Corvettes out, they had the Lambos out.
Big vets.
I said, okay then, I see what type of summer this get ready to be, and I can't wait. I'm going to see if they let me into Coffee and Cars that they do at Austin Land. See if I can get up in there. But when I saw the whips, I started thinking, did the era of big rims die, or did we just age out of that, I guess, that thought process?
I don't think, like, it's dead. I think
like, when's the last time you wanted 30s on your shit?
I never wanted 30s. My name's not LaRell Crowder, my G.
That's not real.
But
like, who's still getting 30s though?
Nobody's getting 30s. I mean, you getting rims that fit naturally on your car and you get a little lift, maybe, you know?
I just I don't see it. I don't see the box Chevys in the 30s in the summer like we used to. It used to be everybody's car. Candy paint, some type of design.
No, that's definitely out of style now. It's foreign.
The foreign?
Yeah. I mean, everybody want the foreign cars.
Did Hov kill it, like he kill everything, when he said, I'm young enough to know the right kind of car to buy, but grown enough not to put rims on it? And then after that, you just traded in your chrome for alloys?
He said pretty much. Pretty mad.
Like, we talked about the JVC,
off, but you know,
and the Pioneer CD player last episode. The rims is gone too.
All that shit gone, bro. Now it's just about the car.
So what? So tint's gonna stay.
Tint ain't never.
Yeah, ain't, right.
Never.
Y'all down to get some 30s just to bring it back to the culture?
I mean,
it's gonna come back.
I got a third on our 30s.
You got a third on the 30s.
Yeah.
Do this podcast on rims, baby. Today's episode, Cartier is going to be the lead on this. So he's going to go through all the topics for us. He's driving this.
I'm driving this motherfucking hoopty, baby. I hope y'all ready to crash.
And I'm a little on edge of my seat because Nationwide talking about he in a mood today. He going to be real vulgar and confrontational.
I'm chill.
Huh? I'm chilling. Oh, so now you chilling.
I'm chill.
All I got to say is business is booming. You hear me?
What that mean?
What that mean? It mean AB went to the Raiders. You hear me?
Damn, I just ruined another receiver's career. Shit.
Call it what you want, bro. It ain't about ruining nobody's career. Randy Moss had a successful season with us. You know what I'm saying? AB's going to come out there, and I think he's more Jerry Rice than Randy Moss. Pretty much, you know, John Gruden, he's stepping back into the coaching realm. And he was able to manage two of the most prolific receivers that the game has seen, Tim Brown and Jerry Rice. So I think that, you know, he's going to be able to do something similar with Antonio Brown, because he is a large personality. And Tim Brown was not as much, but he wasn't a quiet guy like Jerry Rice was.
The biggest thing I see making this work is the fact that there's when you look at the receiving core, there ain't nobody else that AB got to compete with for the ball. Like, that's the biggest thing. AB won his catches, so they going to get him the ball, and I think he going to be satisfied with that. Derek Carr going to come back from the dead again, hopefully. But it's just going to be about getting him the ball. And
he wasn't dead, bro. He was in a coma.
Well, whatever it was, you can call it John Gruden's fault or whatever.
No. Second half of the season, he was solid, though.
And y'all got Jordy, too, right?
Yeah, but he gone, man. Well, I mean, he there, but it don't mean shit.
But I say it's not a OBJ and Jarvis situation where it's like it's two tight receivers that's gonna be wanting the ball.
If we bring back Jared Cook, then we gonna be all right. That's our tight end. He was probably like the second best tight end in the league behind Kelsey.
This is a great move, and y'all didn't give up too much to get him either.
Third and fifth.
So it's a great move for the Raiders. It's the Raiders, man. It's the Raiders.
But the Raiders were in the playoffs a year ago. Or two seasons ago, I should say.
And y'all didn't have the head coach y'all got either.
I understand that. But our quarterback was hurt, and obviously we lost in the first round to the Texans. But I will say this, that cool thing about this is we get to keep Carr. We don't have to worry about drafting a quarterback right now. Because say if we get Carr going this year and shit hits the fan, we always can trade up to get Tua next year or one of the other quarterbacks. What is his name? I think Hubert or mm-hmm. Herbert from Oregon. He's solid. He's a mobile guy. But I think the dynamic, man, between AB, Derek Carr, and Gruden is gonna be so much different than between AB, Tomlin, and Roethlisberger.
Because for sure,
Derek Carr doesn't have an entitledness like Roethlisberger does. He don't rape chicks, you feel me?
Yeah, he's not the only adult on the field with all kids.
So, you know what I mean? And I think Gruden, I don't know if Gruden was really, like, working this hard this early. Like, I ain't going to sit here and say he was that, like, a genius as far as his comments about AB when we played the Steelers this year.
Oh, so he didn't foresee this.
No, that's what I said. I'm not saying that he is. Like, I'm not going to give him that much credit, but if those things are real and that's really how he feels and it's genuine, then I guarantee that went a long way with AB.
Y'all done yet?
Well, Nate, I don't want to hear from you. Like, what Nationwide does, he falls back. He the only one on the show with the computer. So then he formulated a nice argument. I ain't trying to hear that right now. AB on the field is always going to be positive. I don't see anything that's negative with AB on the field. It's going to be, if the Lakers aren't having a winning season, how is he going to react? Now, here's the thing.
The Lakers, though.
The Raiders. Did I say Lakers?
Yeah.
The Raiders. Damn.
You sound like Nate. Jay-Z and Hov.
So, yeah, if the Raiders don't have a winning season, then how is he going to respond? And I'll say this. From my perspective of AB's actions, it doesn't seem to be one that is upset if they're not winning. I think he's upset on the things that certain individuals on the team are able to get away with. And then the expectations of him is greater than what Ben Roethlisberger is. So I don't like he said, like Cartier just said, Derek Carr doesn't have that type of hierarchy on the squad to where that could interfere. So I don't really foresee any locker room issues or anything like that with AB. Obviously, him on the field is always a good news. I don't see anything that's bad about him playing in that uniform other than the coach calling the plays.
And the blonde stash gone, so he's ready to go. Nationwide, what you got to say?
Y'all done yet?
What you got?
I mean, we
come
are
on,
still,
man. Read your damn script.
We are still talking about an organization that's only made the playoffs one time in the last 16 years. I mean, they are the Cleveland Browns of the West Coast.
For sure. But this doesn't mean that this is a bad move
pick
AB.
It's a great move for the Raiders to go get AB. But from an on-the-field standpoint, AB, I don't know if this is a great move for him on the field because he played with a Hall of Fame, future Hall of Fame quarterback in Big Ben. Pittsburgh always competed for the playoffs, so he's used to winning. How is he going to adjust to losing? Like, is he going to be a cancer in the locker room? Is he going to be that diva? For all he want to say that he didn't get the ball or he got mad at Big Ben not throwing the ball, every year he had over 100 receptions. He's had over 1,000 yards for, like, the last 6 or 7 years. I think him and Big Ben has, like, 71 touchdowns together since they've been together, which is the most in the league for any quarterback-receiver duo.
But that's the point, that on the Raiders squad, there's nobody for him to compete with touches with, and also Derek Carr doesn't have that hierarchy that Big Ben has to where Big Ben is going to have the freedom and the liberty to say it whatever he want and even to go back at
it. So you're saying he's going to – they have another choice but to force feed AB.
Oh, they definitely going to force feed him.
True. It's not we don't have another choice, but the thing is bad. He's going to get his 200 targets. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? He's going to have his 100 catches.
But he was getting his targets anyways in Pittsburgh.
But what I'm saying, I understand that, but we gave him the money that he wasn't getting. Like, he wasn't – Bingo. He was getting $900,000 a year. Like, you know what I'm saying? He's getting – like 18 a year now. You know what I'm saying?
Well, so that's just how much he got guaranteed. He was still, as long as he's on the roster, he's going to get paid. Like, I know, the way just Pittsburgh, you know, paid
out
players.
Yeah, the way they structure out their shit is fucked
contracts
up.
And they guarantee like the first year. AB accomplished what he wanted to accomplish.
And
he forced his way out of Pittsburgh. He cashed in. He got more money. He's able to restructure his deal. So AB, like, in terms of business, he won his trade. Pittsburgh looked like I felt they should have got more value back. They got a third and a fifth rounder. So essentially, you gave away. Yeah, you gave away.
I think they chose their locker room over assets.
I mean, I get it. Like, they're going to trade him regardless, but you gave him away. A third and a fifth round for a first ballot Hall of Famer who's in the prime of his career.
Now, how much do you buy in to the fact that, like, the Buffalo Bills deal was on the table and then they pulled out because AB wasn't going to show up? I wouldn't have given a fuck whether he liked to be at Buffalo or not.
Well, the thing is, it would have been the same situation with Pittsburgh. You didn't want to deal with that off-the-field drama and just him being a cancer in the locker room. I think they wanted AB, but with them not wanting to show up, you know he's going to act the ass.
Yeah,
and just be a cancer. So
I know what he wanted to do. He wanted to be closer to L.A. as possible so he can get a couple more shop episodes.
But, like, the only thing – my concern would be is how does he adjust and accept losing? Because, I mean, this trade doesn't make them
better. Man, let me say this.
They don't have a pass rusher, for sure.
You're making it seem like we was just getting like, spanked every game last year. Which is not true. Okay, look, we 2 years away from making the playoffs, and excuse me, and then we lost like 3 or 4 games last year by less than a touchdown. So it's like, at what point do you have to make a move to actually better your team? You know what I'm saying? Like,
oh, you should always make moves to build your team.
Your beginning statement was you about to ruin another receiver. So it's like, You can't say that about every guy you bring in, because then at what point do you bring in a guy? You know what I'm saying? So it's like, did you say that about Cleveland about to ruin Baker Mayfield? You know what I'm saying? Is Cleveland going to ruin Odell Beckham? Like, what about Kenny Britt? What about fucking Perryman? What about Corey Coleman? What about Josh Gordon? Are all those guys ruined by Cleveland? Are you saying Odell Beckham's getting ruined too? So I just think that you have to start somewhere. And I think this is going to be a good mesh between the coach, quarterback, and receiver. And I don't know what's going on with Beast Mode as far as health and stuff. And if we're going to have another back. But
y'all still in Oakland, so he'll be there.
I hope so, because I hope it plays out that way for y'all. The last, I guess, big-name receiver John Gruden, you know, dealt with, he sent them home.
Yeah, but what about the big-name receiver that he had the season prior to that? Two of them. You know what I'm saying? Keyshawn wasn't his guy, though.
I mean, but those were veteran receivers who didn't. Tim Brown and Jerry Rice, no one really considered them divas.
So I guess the bottom line is, with this move, do they leap the Chargers and Chiefs?
No.
Because that's really
that's what I'm saying. No, it's a great move. Who wouldn't want to bring in a Hall of Fame receiver? I agree with that. My concern is, how is he going to adjust to accepting losing?
He's not
because
you got
the Chargers and Chiefs.
Yeah, the Raiders are still going to be losing.
That's not true, bro. That's what I'm saying. It's like you making it seem like this guarantee that we're just going to fucking lose. Like, are the Broncos?
No, we better than y'all too.
So
I don't know, bro. I'm not super confident. All right,
so you say I'm real confident, my G. You know what I'm saying? I think this is the perfect time to put that money where that mouth is.
Hey, that's his go-to. It's always his go-to.
It ain't even training camp yet. What
it don't matter, though.
It's his go-to.
But you can't get on the mic and definitively say that we losers and then try to not put no money on
it. But what does the money prove, though?
It proves that he's behind his statement.
Like, okay.
I mean, let's
just
put
you know what I'm saying?
It's like the I beat you a one-on-one thing. No, you can't, but put some money on it. Like, what that mean?
That means
I get that.
No, bro. That's all I'm saying is don't sit here and call us losers.
I mean, y'all
if
are.
You don't want to put money that we going to finish ahead of y'all in the division.
One playoff in the last 16 years.
Let's go.
Ahead of Broncos is to me, is not saying much. I'm not too confident.
It's not about that, but it's something to him because he just said that we're going to finish below them. He said that. So what I'm saying is that put your money where your mouth is.
I mean, y'all losers, y'all not going to make the playoffs. They have a losing record.
Where your mouth is.
I bet the losing record.
What do you mean? I bet you we finish ahead of y'all.
I bet a losing record.
I bet you finish ahead of y'all.
So let me ask you this. at one point during the training camp, would you be willing to put money on the table to bet?
No, I just want to see who we get through the draft and who else we, you know, build our team with.
Okay, so like, we'll revisit it then.
Yeah, yeah.
So what I'm asking is Flacco going to be used to losing?
Flacco, hey, look, this guy like can't. He can't.
I hate that move.
Like, it's an old man that can't move but can throw a deep ball.
I hate that move.
So
he's a scrub. Yeah. I just think he's a scrub. Like, what has he done? He literally hasn't done anything since he won the fucking Super Bowl.
The only thing
go
I
to
can,
Eli Manning. That's another quarterback who hasn't done anything since they won the Super Bowl. And the Giants wanted to commit to him.
The only thing I could think of with John Elway making this move is that I think he's now feeling the criticism of missing on so many quarterbacks since Peyton Manning left. And it's like, if I can bring in somebody that I can at least say is a Super Bowl champion, then maybe people will feel like I'm trying to make a move now to go win. Because we got a defense that can still get it done in the playoffs, but an offense that is not thriving under Case Keenum. And now we got somebody in Joe Flacco that is not too much of an upgrade.
Yeah, he's not an upgrade. He literally hasn't done the Ravens haven't made the playoffs since they won the fucking Super Bowl.
But you can lean on the fact and say, well, I brought in the Super Bowl champion. If John Elway, that's the only thing I can gather his thought process of why he brought this guy
in. I can't, and I don't think fans will buy into that because that was, what, 6 years ago at this point?
And see,
like, you can't lean on that.
And see, I was talking about this at work. Like, the only move that Elway could make is to overpay somebody, but who can he overpay? No,
I would rather for him, like, if we, like, clearly we're in rebuilding mode.
No, I don't believe the defense believes that.
Well, no, defensively, I think we have the defense to compete right now, but offensively, we're still trying to rebuild our offensive line. Who's going to be our receivers?
But you can't.
We have two young, decent running
backs.
You
can't be in rebuild on one side of the ball
and not the other.
But here's the thing. With the defense that we have, I think we can plug in a fucking rookie quarterback and play from day one. We can trade up and draft Dwayne Haskins. We could get Kyler Murray. I think we could compete from day one with a rookie quarterback.
You name two QBs.
Better than we could.
And if we don't get either one of them, then what?
No, you trade up. That's come with him being a GM, making maneuvers throughout the draft to you know, gain assets and move up. That happens all the time. So I would rather have went that route than go to another quarterback that's been around who hasn't done a lick of shit over the last 5 or 6 years.
A lick of shit.
Like, and then
been hanging with white people too long.
And then we go to, like,
what?
Since we're on these quarterbacks, we go to the Giants. You trade away Odell, but you're still paying Eli like $20+ million a year, and he hasn't done anything. Yeah, and he's
stupid.
Not your future.
Giants stupid.
He's not your future. So why would you commit to Eli over a young receiver that's in his prime? I don't get it.
Yeah, it don't really make sense. I mean,
you know. Yo, so this article that just popped up on Snapchat, and Snapchat is not the reliable news source, but it says this woman had a stroke while receiving oral sex from her mate. A stroke, bro?
Freak.
If somebody got head game like that, do you want it? Like, would you be willing to have a stroke over a good head like that?
Stroke out over some head, bro. That's deep.
Why nationwide stinking though? Like, you willing to risk your life?
Hey, wait. Yeah, yo.
I don't want them problems.
I don't want them problems.
He's swaying left and right, like,
keep that shit away from me, bro. That, like, you willing to die for it? Yeah. Why you laughing? Answer a question.
Fuck
you willing?
Fuck
it.
He said fuck it. What
you
is it?
Once, bro. You going out on top.
What does it all once, mean?
That's crazy, though. That's crazy.
Bro, hey, you learn something new about people every day, bro.
Yeah, bro. I thought I knew this guy until he was like, yeah, I struck out over some face.
So how are you willing to find out who has that ability, though?
I don't think you can. I think that's just a spur of the moment thing.
He said, like, I'm going to swing back to last week's show.
Like, would you be willing to go on a trip for it?
When I shut up. Oh, shit. Hey, but when I seen that headline, I'm like, bro, this shit can't be real. It's hard for me to even believe that.
Yeah, that shit wild. I don't want it. Keep that shit away. I ain't willing to die for it like Nationwide is. But that's a special guy, man.
Fuck it, bro.
All right, Cardia, continue. Goddammit, you leading.
I mean, bro, I mean, we were just talking about what you was talking about. Bad, you know what I'm saying? I mean, what you mean? Damn. I mean, you talking about fire ass head and all that. So I
did
mean,
yeah, jump around.
Yeah, I jumped.
You
Sorry.
Jumped way off of
Sorry
that.
Sorry about that.
So, something I wanted to talk about, man, that ain't related to the fire stroke dinner. So, modern day things, man, that make black being cool. I mean, because being black, man, it's like a stigma. Like, you know, you there's the angry black man syndrome. You know, it's the black man walking with, if your clothes too baggy and you're black, it's like, damn, he gotta be trouble. But you know, if you're white, it's kind of like, that's just your swag. It's almost like, I guarantee, bro, if a black dude had on the exact same thing a white dude had on, as far as like more so fitted jeans, but with a bigger like hoodie on, which is almost like the new Pac Sun feel, it's viewed completely different. So my question was what's some modern day things that make being black cool? And the example of this, if y'all don't understand what I'm asking, is like Obama becoming president. Like, he definitely put being black on a pedestal.
Well, and let's clear this up, because being black has always been been cool. So what made being black and black culture pop culture?
Yeah, okay, Gotcha.
What? I would say, if we're looking at it from the stance of fashion, I think for women it's confidence, for males it's strength. Like, the blackness that and the strength of a man that walks around confident in his own black skin, I think other cultures see that and they definitely want to be a part of that. Yeah. Especially when you wear it, like you said, any type of outfit and just have the confidence in it. Same with women. When you hear women talk about clothing, then they say, I wish I could pull that off. But you look at a beautiful black woman, she confident in whatever she wearing, and she walk in stride, and she just looks so godly and beautiful. Like,
you said godly.
For real. So I just think like that. But I just think personality and the way that we willing to are able to adapt to anything, it's just something that other cultures want to gravitate to and be a part of. So that, I mean, that I, that's, so that's like an example as far as like fashion.
It's like the strut.
You said what?
The strut, kind of like, you know what I'm saying? Like the way you carry yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. So that was the like an example of like fashion sense. But I just think it's we have molded culture for some time now. Black Twitter, we say that a lot, but that's real. Black Twitter really runs the responses of the masses. If we want a response from a certain person, Black Twitter will get it. If we want somebody canceled, Black Twitter will make it happen. If the culture is not rocking with this certain person, Black Twitter is going to make sure that nobody's rocking with you. It's a real thing. We've always molded cultures, and we've done it for a long time. Hell, Henry Ford, he created the plant, but they credit him for creating the vehicle. Henry Ford wasn't the creator of the automotive. It was a black man that did it. So we've been doing this for a while. We've been doing this for a long time. The African-American man that was the creator of the Super Soaker, he didn't get credit for it. You know what I'm saying? But now he got a settlement. He got his money for being the actual creator of the Super Soaker. So we've been doing this for a while. This wave has been stolen for a while. So the question was, what are modern day things? I don't really know about modern day, because it's been happening for a long time. I just think now we are demanding our credit for shit. We are demanding that we get our just due whenever we are the creators of anything. And I just think that's what's going on lately.
Nice.
To echo you, I think black culture, hip hop culture, has always been in. It's always been followers and people gravitating to our culture. Like, even just watching like sports, like you can hear going in and out of commercial breaks, they playing a rap song.
Yeah,
like the NBA, it's rap music. You know, on the speakers or whatever.
And we just, you know, the rhythm. Rest in peace, man. Boom Shakalaka, the cooler than outside the pillow. What's his name? I can't think of it.
Stuart Scott.
Recipe, Stuart Scott. He changed the way SportsCenter is ran. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
So, definitely. So, I mean, this is something that's been around forever. I think it's just now been pop. It's finally become like accepted in terms of pop culture. And the modern day thing that I hate to say this, I hate to get his family credit for it.
What? Kardashian?
The Ray J sex tape. Well, it's, fuck that. It's Ray J's credit. The Ray J sex tape is what made this shit acceptable, in my opinion, because all of a sudden,
rewind that. Ray J sex tape made what?
Black culture, pop culture. Made it set, like, that's when we seen the transition to where every music genre wanted to get a rapper on their song. All, you know, black shows, black movies, white people dressing like black people. I think that's when it really started to take off. More white women been okay with dating black men openly. I think that's kind of when it started to take off, in my opinion.
So we about to give Ray J all the credit.
I need some examples.
I'm going to give Ray J that credit, bro, because I just think that's once, like, you got this white family that where they all date black men.
I got to call in some backup on you,
so let me call
I think that's when this happened, bro.
But I hear you. But
I don't have no facts to back it up. That's just what I'm going with.
Yo, Boogie. Hello?
Yes.
You are live on the pod. So I'm calling you because I want you to get at Nationwide for me. And you may not, but I think he deserves it right now. So the question.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, so the question that was asked was, Meech asked, what are some modern day things that made black culture cool, or I guess, or black culture acceptable?
Pop culture. Like, what made black culture pop?
And our example was President Obama.
Yeah, that's the one Meech gave.
Yeah, Obama, so, after the fact, he late.
Nationwide had a nerve to say it was Ray J who made it acceptable because he fucked Kim K on video.
What?
Yeah, man, I'm going with that.
Educate him, please.
Ray J made black culture pop nowadays because he has sex with Kim K.
Yeah.
That's what he's telling you. The thoughts and views of Nationwide are not of mine.
Can you name something better?
Is that Nate? Do you feel this way because you feel like the Kardashians are representative of black culture being popular right now?
Are they? Repeat that.
I was asking if you're saying that because you feel like the Kardashians are representative of black culture being so popular right now. Why do you feel like it's it has anything to do with the Kardashians?
Because I think a lot of white people, Caucasians, not to sound racist or whatever, I think a lot of Caucasians follow.
Stop calling them Caucasians. That's not extra racist.
Right.
They're Caucasians.
Whatever. I didn't say the Caucasians. But no, I feel like a lot of white people are influenced by the Kardashian family. So once they like, oh, this white famous family that love black people, I think that became okay for all white people to fuck with the hip-hop coach.
I'm not going to say, like, you don't have a valid point. I just can't agree that I feel like that's what makes black culture so popular. Like, I feel like black culture was popular before the Kardashians.
Oh, for sure. I said that before I gave credit to Ray J. It wasn't giving credit to Kardashians, to Ray J.
That's hilarious.
To Ray J. Just Ray J. That's it. You know, Ray J.
Yo,
I'll talk about, like now, when was black culture ever not popular? They stole everything from us historically.
For sure.
Exactly. That's what I was telling
them. So when was there a time that black culture stuff? They don't love black people. But when was black culture not it?
Well, no. It wasn't necessarily saying that it wasn't ever popping. It was just we was discussing some current things that kind of moved it to another level. Another thing is kind of
like the fact that now hip hop is considered to be the most popular form. Of music.
Yeah, exactly. Same thing with like Black Panther, Wakanda,
or like. Even though black culture has always been popular, but it were some aspects of black culture that had negative connotations, like twerking. Everyone twerks now.
Or dreads.
Dreads is in, but I think that's still within our culture for the most part. You don't see too many people, white people, with dreads unless they fucking surfers.
They live in Yellow Springs.
I was about to say, y'all say that still live in Ohio. Y'all should see some of these small folks in Florida. That's all I'll say.
They surf, right? I guarantee you. But my example with twerking, that had a negative connotation early on back in the 99, 2000. But now it's like everyone do it.
So you're saying Miley made it acceptable?
But Miley is influenced by the Kardashians.
Is she?
Yes, bro.
I don't know.
Man, what I said make a lot of sense.
No, what did they just say? No, I do feel like Miley Cyrus brought twerking like back into popular culture just with her. Whatever level of popularity she's at that time, because she is just wilding out, she had a little mole, a Robin Thicke, and all of that. In white culture, that definitely made it popular. Obviously, we all know twerking has been around forever.
Yeah.
But for sure, when you talk about like mainstream, it takes some popular white person. That's why I said, like, Nate, I can't say that you bring up the Kardashians, because obviously their appeal, their popularity is crazy. So it does take usually some white person who's very popular in like mainstream America to bring something, just like they do with French braids, like everything. Oh,
another example. Yep.
Freaking, what's her name? Kendall Jenner is wearing French braids. That's a new thing. Are you kidding?
Yep.
Right.
Even her, she the one who got her lips done too, right?
The white people are wearing Timberland, so that's the new fall season trend. Are you kidding?
Right. Right. And Boogie tell him, you had French braids in third grade.
Listen.
Hey, she used to rock the shit out of them mugs in Miss Bad Class.
My French braids forever.
How's Florida?
Straight back. Florida is good. I've had a long day, but Florida is good. I know y'all weather is trash, so I don't want
to
hurt y'all feelings.
No, it's great
today. Nah, Boogie, Boogie. Our weather is the shit's naive.
Exactly. And like, what she'll do... She'll do bullshit like send me a picture of the like the sunshine in Florida when it's like snowing here. This shit I deal with.
I sent you a picture of Rihanna waving in a pool. I didn't send you a picture outside my window. I just said it was just me. You know, she's one of the rare black people I can find on the moon. So I send you Rihanna and you just got a set. And then I sent you Eddie Murphy on the beach. Like, I'm just sending you black people.
Because you knew what you was doing.
No, Florida is good though. I'm waiting on everybody to come visit. But well, I know Nate Newton here.
Yeah, I was just
the
down
holidays.
There.
I didn't catch up with you on that.
I didn't hit you up. He ain't shit. You hear him? I didn't hit you up, cuz.
He didn't think about it. Before I let you go though.
Yeah, I know.
Any thoughts on Aunt Becky from Full House paying to get her kids into college?
Johnny, you know I could go all day on this shit. I lived for this story yesterday. Oh my God.
Like, this shit has been going on though, right? It's just now been caught.
Absolutely. I think the most shocking thing, I talked about this all day at work yesterday, and I know all the different like TV shows are talking about it today. I think the main thing that people are shocked about is not that it's happening, but that they're actually going after them for it. Like, this is not just your local police. This is the FBI coming for y'all. So whether are they actually going to serve jail time, though, that's the question. Like, I think the main ringleader dude is probably going to go to jail. You know, $25 million over, what, 8 years? Like, he's going to go down. But, like, Aunt Becky with the $500,000, Felicity Huffman with the $15,000, like, that's probably the more minor. Whatever parent pays $6.5 million for their kids to get their SAT second or get in school, whatever, yeah, they may be looking at a little bit of jail time. Today, they just said, yesterday they were saying, oh, they could get up to 5 years. Today, they're saying they could get up to 20.
I just don't understand. Like, if you're paying that much money, how much does Harvard cost? Like, won't you just pay this tuition?
Yeah, but they have to get accepted into the school.
Gotcha.
That's the thing. It's not even like Harvard. Like, there were a couple, they said, oh, Yale or Stanford. Freaking Aunt Becky University is getting USC.
Yeah, USC, yeah.
Is it that competitive at USC?
And what's crazy is that... I'm Becky's daughter. I had no idea until I read the article that she's a YouTube star, like 2 million YouTube subscribers and shit like that.
But that made her look bad, too, because they brought up old clips of her where she was talking about, oh, I don't really care about school.
Right.
This and that. So it makes her already seem, you know, very ungrateful. Or like, oh, I see why you had to pay for your daughter to get into school, because obviously she wasn't going to make it. But, I mean, I just think it's crazy. Again, I think most people assume that these privileged parents get their kids. And one thing I'm talking on the radio today, too, is, you know, it's not just college. You know, these people, when you get to this level, you pay for your kids to go to the best, like, preschool, the best kindergarten, the best this and that. So that's just, they've reached that level where, oh, they're even paying off college coaches and academic advisors and all these people to get your kids. They're like, it's a conspiracy for sure, but it's something I think that the wealthy and the privileged have been used to getting away with for a long time. So I'm just, again, shocked that they're actually going to try to, when they say they were indicting them and they came to Felicity Huffman's house,
lock
and
their ass up.
I was like, oh my God, y'all
lock them down.
And,
I didn't know
Aunt Becky's husband was Mosimo. So shout out to Target for putting him out years ago.
Exactly.
They saw.
They said yesterday. I Googled him so quick. I said, that shit at Target. I already know that brand. He
Mr. Mosimo.
He was like, oh, that shit at Target. Yes, he's a multimillionaire.
Man, that shit wild. Well, all right, I'm going to let you go. I appreciate you for coming on and going back and forth with Nationwide. But yeah, that shit crazy.
Again, I didn't discredit Nate's statements because I think it's very valid. When you make Kylie Jenner a billionaire off a lip gloss, I can't argue.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
that's crazy.
Oh, I got you. I feel you. All right, guys.
All right, see you.
All right, thank you.
Mom. All right. Bye.
Now, to think about that Aunt Becky situation, that they're paying to get their kids into school, The only thing, when I read the article, I sat back and I said, when do they start coming at players that's got full rides who know they didn't take the test? Someone else took the test. I mean, because, like, if the wealthy gonna fall, like, you ain't holding them to a code of ethics.
Fuck that. They've been coming out players forever. Like, that's what the whole Derrick Rose
but
situation.
But I feel like they get ready to snitch.
It may happen, but whatever. Like,
they said 6'9 told on IPEC.
Like, what's crazy about that, though, is like, okay, say if your child wanted to go to Harvard, got turned down, didn't get accepted. If they're smart enough to, like, pay, like, for you to pay, bribe people, but you, and get them accepted, they probably could have went to still a good school, like Duke or Northwestern or something like that.
Bluffton.
But
it's
just stupid. Why would you pay $5 million or whatever astronomical number for your kid to attend a school on top of still paying tuition? Like, between you being a wealthy person, a CEO, an actress, or whatever, you already have a network built. So any school that they go to get a degree, they can use your fucking network to maneuver throughout their career once they get out in the real world. So I mean, it's just a white collar crime that, you know, they thought they was gonna get away with.
So the thing is, would you take the money
and run?
No, like, if you're talking in about admissions, would you take the money and get them, because, like, that's a lot to turn down. Now, this shit, this shit wrong as fuck. Any type of, like, crime where you can get them, go ahead and lock their ass up. I was just, like, these are things you just come to my mind.
Like, if I'm in admissions, man, put myself in their feet.
In their shoes, bro.
In their feet.
They hold foot.
Put myself in their shoes. That's funny. I don't know. I'll turn out that money, man. I'm not about to sit here and sound like the most moral person and, like, turning down a $400,000 check just to approve somebody's application. I don't know. I'll turn that down, to be honest. Like, because at the end of the day, you're like, what harm am I doing? I'm not really hurting anyone. I'm just stamping this application approved. Now, granted, by you doing that shit, it's probably somebody that you know, would have qualified that you turned down.
Because, like, Aunt Becky's daughter got in on a crew scholarship, and she ain't played crew a day in her life.
Like,
how do you play crew, by the way? Is you just do crew? I don't know if you play crew.
Competing
in crew?
Crew?
It's like, I want to say canoeing, I guess. Yeah, I don't know what type of it is.
It's like a canoeing race.
Like,
you,
rowing.
Yeah, you race against, like, other shoes.
Row your boat.
The only thing about this situation is, like, when you ask a question like that, what would you do? Everyone, like, oh, it's a crime. It's 3 to 5 years in jail. I wouldn't do that shit. Come on, man. Let's be real.
When you sitting in that office and they walk in there with a briefcase or that check.
Yeah, because people in the admissions office don't make that much, and they probably got student loans racked up, a $400,000 check.
Said, cash me out.
Like, I don't know how. I don't know what I would have done in that situation.
Right. All right, Cartier, continue.
I mean, bro, you can't be doing me like that, bro.
What's your modern day black?
Yeah, that's moment. Right. Yeah.
I don't have one. You know what I'm saying? Don't be worried about how I'm feeling.
Don't worry about it, sweetheart.
Don't worry about it. But something we need to talk about, man. You know, 2018, 2019 is definitely like the movement for women empowerment. Women. You know what I'm saying?
Who are women?
Stop it. So. You know, there we had a woman host the Emmys. We didn't have a host for the Oscars. We had a woman host the Grammys. Shout out to Alicia Keys. So, you know, they definitely are getting the opportunities that they deserve now.
For sure.
And definitely moving forward with progression as far as, I don't know, I guess opportunities. So, something I want to talk about. Have y'all... I like go see movies. Like, I'm super geeked about premieres and yada yada. So, especially Marvel. Have either one of y'all seen Captain Marvel? You seen it?
I've seen it.
Jay Will?
No, I've not seen it yet.
Not yet. All right. So, this is kind of related
Netflix when they come out next.
So, yeah, we can spoil.
All right. So, we're not going to spoil the movie, but we are going to talk about something about it. So, this is a kind of spoiler that we'll give you that. Just, I would say, roll 10 minutes through. We're not going to talk about details of the movie, but kind of the basis of it. So, in Marvel movies, really not just Marvel, DC too, with Wonder Woman, this kind of was a recurring situation. So Captain Marvel, let's say she was the first female lead in a Marvel movie in the MCU. So the recurring theme in that movie. Well, first, before we get to this, Nate, what did you think of the movie?
I think it was a good movie overall. It's obviously it's not the I wouldn't put it a top five Marvel movie, but I liked it. I enjoyed it, and it's enough storylines to keep you intrigued and looking forward to the MCU future.
Is that your honest opinion?
Yeah, honestly.
I didn't know whether you had to say that because you is a female lead.
No. Okay. I really enjoyed the movie, and like I said, it's enough storylines and like teasers.
Nice.
Plus, I go in like once I watch a movie, I start going reading articles. What this character is going to be three movies down the road and shit like that.
I'm real proud of you, bro. You ain't being toxic on this,
no,
okay?
No.
Good.
I may get toxic in a minute, but okay. Not right now.
All right. So before you get toxic, as far as my opinion about the movie, I think that it was a great movie, man. Like, nothing's better than a movie that touches on a lot of, like, different points. Draymond weak as fuck. But it touches on a lot of different points, like, you get humor, you get some witty comedy, you get some good-ass Samuel L. Jackson, you know what I'm saying? You get a strong woman performance, then you got a twist, you know? Nothing's better than those things. So, I enjoyed the movie thoroughly.
What was the plot? Like, what was she trying to accomplish?
It's really hard to give me a synopsis because I'm not good at writing those.
Like a plot without giving away too much?
I would say it's about a woman who is
a superhero.
Yeah, but I'm saying it's a woman who is a superhero who's recouping her memories slowly through the movie.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like much. That.
Is there what's the climax?
We can't say that without giving away the movie.
Give it away, shit.
No, we're not giving it away. So, but like I was saying, it's a great movie, man. It's definitely had a lot of Easter eggs, as you would put it. Things to look forward to. If you have any prior knowledge to the Captain Marvel character, you start picking up on stuff, and then even afterwards, you can kind of read into things and watch YouTube videos that'll put you on the game for future movies and things like that. So, the main thing and reason I brought this up, besides just giving the movie praise, is in this movie and in other female-led movies that are for superheroes.
Wonder Woman.
Wonder Woman. Their full power is being suppressed by a male to protect, air quotes, this said female. And do y'all think this is happening in real life?
So a woman's full power is being suppressed by a male.
Yeah, so like,
I don't remember that in Wonder Woman.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to remember. Wonder Woman. Like it's definitely
she had a love interest, but like
if you seen
see hers wasn't necessarily being suppressed by a man, but it was more so kind of like I got this fake sword that's here, you know what I mean? It's like we training you to be this, but we don't want y'all to meet the man in the real world because they're gonna break y'all down and get into your head. So we're gonna stay on this Amazonian country or whatever island and keep you away from the real world, pretty much.
Right.
So it wasn't necessarily being suppressed by a man, but it was being suppressed like we don't trust you to fuck with the other gender.
Well, okay, before I dive in, I need to know if I need to get toxic or not. is this just like one of your questions that you had, or did you see like some type of controversy out there?
Nah, this is just me.
Okay.
This is literally just me.
All right. I thought it was like controversy behind that question. So what is your opinion,
regardless of who answers?
No. Because, no, my opinion changed. If it's just a general question to answer that, no, I definitely believe that like a lot of women's full potential is being blocked. I mean, because they don't get a lot of opportunity. Like, they don't get the same opportunities as men. They're not paid equally as men. So when you think about it from that aspect and that standpoint, they can't realize their full potential in a lot of cases. Like, we know women can be managers. They can lead teams and things of that nature. They can be, you know, great scientists or whatnot, great doctors. So to not give them that opportunity, that is blocking them.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the whole fight right now is equal pay, equal opportunity. And then there's the fight of for women's equal pay and equal opportunity. But then there's the black woman equal pay and equal opportunity for black women as well. So, yeah, that is the fight that I feel like has gotten a lot stronger. I really feel like they're definitely making progress. There's still a long ways to go. But to also, when we talk about power suppression, the first thing that came to my mind was how the black male is in some ways sheltered by the black woman. And a lot of it is by choice, because there are black women that knows what a black man faces on a day-to-day basis when he goes out into the world. So I think, and this has been historical, to where a black woman will sacrifice their gifts and ability to either be a homemaker or to make sure that the black male knows his worth when he returns home. So for years, you know, you've have a black woman that may not go out into the working world and generate income, because she is sacrificing to stay home, because when that black man returns home, she wants him to be treated like a king like that. So I think, yeah, it's definitely indicative of real life in that aspect and in working world. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, that's cool that y'all actually can, like, you know, apply this to real life, because I definitely agree. I think it is something that we're dealing with in everyday culture. It's weird, because, you know, I hate talking about personal, like, people that I know and things like that. So just say I know somebody who pretty much, like, he doesn't cook, he doesn't do anything as far as, like, not necessarily taking care of their kid, but, like, as far as pretty much he got his chick, like, waiting on him, on his hand and foot, you know what I'm saying, like, daily, you know what I'm saying, like, yeah, he brings in money and stuff, but it's like, you don't give her the opportunity to pretty much have free time to do things, you know what I'm saying?
And I can almost guarantee that if she decided one day that she wanted to do something for herself,
it would be a big deal.
It'd be a big deal.
It'd be a big deal. Like, yeah, what do you mean you're going to the gym? To with who? You know what I'm saying? Shit like that. So you just got, like, shit like that that's going on, and it's kind of it's just wrong to me. You know, it's just like the fact that I understand, like, this. Okay, I'm lighten this up a little bit, but. I was watching The Practical Jokers, man, and
that's my shit.
And at the end, you know, you get a punishment if you lose throughout the challenges. So they told the guy, like, yo, you need to go to this women's conference and you need to disagree with everything these women are saying. So there was, like, you know, one of the topics was something I'm tired of hearing is that, you know, that's a man's job. You know what I'm saying? Or it's a man's world or something like that. So the thing that they brought up was he was like, I mean, I agree with that, you know? You know, it's like Michelle Obama is an example. And he was like, you know, she's only famous because her husband was elected to president. Bruh, you should have seen the faces of the women in the crowd, bro. That shit was so funny, and it cracked me up because, you know, obviously he can go full throttle in that moment. And then this capture and the live reactions are real. But immediately after, he stands up and says, hey, I'm just fucking with y'all. We recording the show. It's funny. Everybody's like, ha, ha, ha. You know, I support women. I donate such and such from the show to y'all organization. So, you know, he doesn't catch real flack for it at the end of the day.
Yeah.
But in the moment, that shit is classic.
You know what's even more fucked up?
What?
Is that comment may not been wrong, though. Like,
I know.
She should be famous, but not successful,
right? I know, but yeah, exactly. But that's just what crazy. Like, she wouldn't be the first lady if there wasn't a president who was the first man. And it's just like, bro, he was just going in and in. That shit was just classic. But you gotta love women, man. Definitely appreciate y'all, what y'all do. And like Nationwide said, is pretty much like, yeah, there's nothing wrong with. Yeah, obviously, you can manage a team as good as a man or better. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, some physical labor jobs, obviously, it's like, man, you can't be having some women.
Hey, that's toxic.
No, it's not, bro. I said some women lifting, you know, a bunch of shit, especially, like, if you're pregnant and things like that. So,
Holly
obviously,
Mango would beg to differ.
Right.
So, there are women who are, like, ninja warriors who definitely are into their fitness, you know what I'm saying, who do shit like that. So, yeah, of course, you need to hire them, but if there is a job where you have to literally lift 100 pounds a day, regardless, men or women, you need to be able to do it. You know what
yeah,
I'm saying?
I mean, that, yeah, that's the requirement of the job, of course. Yeah. But
how do you feel about, like, since we're on the topic of movies, how do you feel about people who are up in arms that Will Smith was selected to play, I want to say Serena Williams' daddy in a biopic? Because Will Smith is not as dark-skinned as Serena Williams' father.
Showing.
So there's one example. And then the Aladdin trailer just launched. And some are saying
that's been a big issue.
That Jasmine isn't as dark as they would like, and that Aladdin isn't as dark as they would like.
Well, I mean, that's a whole conversation.
And I've heard people having a hissy fit about Will Smith being casted as Genie and in comparison to Robin Williams.
I mean, the comparison will happen regardless, because Robin bodied that. Well, but I think what Will Smith did yesterday was pretty cool, where he said, I know Genies don't have shoes, but Robin, you left big shoes to fill. So him paying homage to Robin Williams, I think it's going to have some fans like, all right, let's live with it.
In this movie, the Genie is kind of like an iconic figure. Same issue with people don't want a black James Bond. People didn't want a black Superman. So that's just that.
I don't think they were – I didn't see outrage about Will Smith being black and playing him.
Yeah, I haven't seen
it. It was just more so like, just don't do it because nobody can fill Robin Williams' shoes.
So who the fuck else is going to be the Genie?
right.
Like,
that's what I saw.
You don't do Aladdin without an actual Genie? Like, that don't make sense.
And I got into an argument with a coworker talking about, you know what I'm saying, it should be a comedian. I'm like, he is a fucking comedian.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, he's funny as fuck. Did you watch Fresh Prince, motherfucker? Right. You know what I'm saying? And
the trailer looked dope, bro.
He was like, you need somebody like, what made Robin Williams so good was that he was quick twitch with, like, all his jokes and all that. I was like, bro, you don't think Will Smith can do that?
Yeah, Will Smith.
I was like, bro,
he
got that, and he's one of the most polished actors in the game, white or black. You know what I'm saying?
The whole Aladdin, because the movie is in Egypt, which is Africa. That goes back to what was the other movie where it was another movie based in Egypt, and it was all white fucking
actors. Are you talking about the Mexican play by Brad Pitt?
Movie in Egypt, and it was all white
actors. Persian Prince?
It might have been that, or it might have been like Gods of Egypt or some shit like that.
I think those two actors are Arabic, though.
But the thing about it is that there's portions of Africa that they don't look dark skinned. You know what I'm saying? They look like they're from the Middle East. And that's exactly what this is. And
that's what Aladdin is.
Yes.
The other movie I'm talking about with white actors.
Aladdin or Jasmine are not played by white actors, though.
Right. They're played by actors that are
Middle Eastern.
Yeah.
So I don't get the controversy
because they're not dark enough Middle Easterns. Just like with Will Smith. He's a black man, but he's not a black enough man to play this role. It's colorism, when is Will Smith not black enough?
I'm not going to say get the fuck out of here to, like, Middle Easterns, because I feel like if they want to make that argument or
It's other people.
That's their right. But if it's white people or if it's black people, I don't think we should be the ones making the argument in terms of Aladdin, you know what I mean?
And I'm just looking at the cartoon. I'm like, I don't remember Aladdin being that dark.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
He's the same complexion as the man who's playing him now.
Exactly.
Same thing as Jasmine.
So I'm sad of that. But the whole Serena Williams thing, or father, like, I understand the argument with that, because he was a dark-skinned man, and you would like to see a dark-skinned man get the role. Like, I understand it still went to a black person, but it's like, you would want to see a dark-skinned people, like, the people who are concerned with, you know, colorism and skin complexion.
Yeah.
Like me, I care less, but I can understand that. And typically you don't see this.
I got a question too. When you,
typically, okay. Typically you don't see this issue come up with men, because black men, whether if you're light skin, dark skin, whatever, you've always then got roles throughout movies, like throughout history. I mean, everything going back to Sidney Poitier to present day Idris Elba, like, dark skinned man has always gotten roles. So,
I don't know. I think Wesley Snipes and Jungle Fever kind of put us on the map as far as roles.
I mean, he just said, you know, he continued it. You know what I mean? Yeah. But it's been like, it's something to where black men have always gotten roles, regardless if you're light skinned, dark skinned. This is a major issue when it comes to women, because anytime you see a movie with a leading actress, like, especially
it's light skin.
It's typically light skin, especially if they're a love interest. So, like, if they're in a movie and they got a husband, 9 times out of 10 is going to be a light skin woman. So this is where that issue came into play, the whole colorism. So that argument to where he's not dark enough.
Shout out to Annalise Keating.
I think that's something that women have been making a argument. Black women have been saying forever. And that goes back to the whole standards, the standard beauties of a woman.
Yeah.
It's typically something that's closer to whiteness. So, I mean, it's a valid argument.
So you're talking about the Dove commercial. What was your question, Meek?
I don't even fucking remember now. What was Nationwide just talking about?
Colorism.
A little bit before that. He was talking about
Serena Williams' dad.
Oh, yeah. So what's more important? Like, is it more important that you're the right skin and you're a shitty actor, or you're a great actor and you just a shade lighter?
I don't think that's a valid question, though, because
both can exist, is what you're saying?
Both, like you I could be a dark skin and still be a great
asking
actor.
You. No, I'm asking you. I didn't ask you. I said, what's it more important to you?
I think no, it's not
the,
this. I think,
the most important thing for me is the story. To tell the story. Well, good. Exactly. Tell the right story.
No, so I'm saying, if there's two scenarios I'm giving you. Which one would you prefer? A light-skinned actor who's a great actor and gets it right, or a dark-skinned actor who looks just like this motherfucker who is a shitty actor?
I want the best quality, so I would go with the light-skinned actor in that scenario.
It depends.
You ain't gonna throw Jackson Avery from Grey's Anatomy out there.
Well,
but like Will Smith, he's a versatile guy, bro. He can get real fucking ugly.
We
can't put Cottonmouth in everything because he's dark skinned. But I'm just
Black
saying.
Panther. Like, he could have played. But, I mean, it's tons of black dark skinned guys.
Here's my thing. The reason why I say it, bro, it first depends of all, is
Will
that
Smith is not light skinned.
But he's not as dark as the guy he's playing. But the reason why I said it depends is because I don't think her dad is the focal point in the movie. He's not the main character. So if it's the main character, I'm gonna try to get closer realistic as possible. I don't want a light skinned as Malcolm or Martin Luther King. You know what I'm saying? Right. I'm gonna try to get somebody closer to Selma.
I agree.
But if the movie is about Serena and her dad is played by Will Smith, I want Will Smith the name to bring attention to this movie. You know what I'm saying? I would try to get to most close to realism as possible. Especially if you're going to watch a biopic, you're going to be watching to see a nigga that look like Heavy D playing Biggie Smalls. No, you want dark skin, black, ugly as ever, Biggie Smalls.
I want the movie to be, I would like it to be as realistic as possible.
Exactly.
We're going to have a black ass Drake in the biopic. You know what I'm saying? So I get it. You want it as real as possible, but I just don't think her dad is the main focus.
It's all about, like, the lead or a supporting role. You know what I'm saying? That definitely was a good point that you made, is which role is he playing? You know what I mean?
Right.
So, I mean, I don't think it's a big deal because, one, Will Smith is huge in the acting game. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, I think he's going to do it justice, pretty much. I mean, but think about it, bro. Like, I don't know if Will Smith, the dude from Concussion, was way darker, but it didn't matter. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so,
Will Smith made you watch it, for sure.
Exactly, he made you watch it. Same thing with this. He gonna make you watch this movie because he's a portion of it.
You ever seen Gridiron Gang?
Yeah.
The Rock played the head coach, but the head coach in real life is a white dude.
See, exactly. You know what I'm saying? It's like, wasn't nobody tripping about that shit.
I was like, that was wild. At the end of the movie, I was like, he played a white dude this whole time? But movie's dope.
Nah, but I mean, I get it. Like, I think this is an argument that black women have typically made because they wasn't seeing the roles. I don't think black men really gave two fucks about it because they've gotten roles. Like, Will Smith, some of these other actors, Denzel, like, they've always gotten roles regardless. So, I don't think it's been that big of an issue with black men.
All right, Cartier, what you got next, brother?
Man.
Moving right along.
Bro, you funny, man. I swear to God. Like, why you just can't let me just move into my topic?
My mate? Bad.
You just like cutting off the topic. All right, Nate, you done with that shit? Nate, meet what you got. But if you want to do it like that, I mean, we got to talk about a lot of this NBA shit. I mean, we got James Dolan kicking motherfuckers out. We got people getting banned for life, you know what I'm saying, in Utah. So would y'all rather talk about Dolan or would y'all talk about Utah first?
Let's talk about Utah. All
right, so in Utah, we had Westbrook versus my man Shane Kiesel. All right, so Shane Kiesel is a fan who was two or three up, you know what I'm saying, baseline, real close to Russell Westbrook and the Thunder bench. So, you know, whole game, he was kind of heckling him, saying things that were racial and or homosexual. We're not sure yet, you know. It just depends on how you take it. But
whatever he said, it got his ass banned. It must have been
it definitely derogatory. Got Westbrook riled up. And so what happened was, he said, the quote was, "Get down on your knees like you used to Russell Westbrook." And Russell Westbrook looked over at him, screamed at him, and said, I'll fuck you and your wife up, all right? So, you know, at that point, he threatened a woman, he threatened a man, and it was taken initially as Russell Westbrook cannot threaten a woman, you know, that he just randomly, you know what I mean? This is not the right thing to do. But then the story changed. 3 hours later, you know, everybody started screenshotting my man Kiesel's tweets. Pretty much he had it out for Westbrook from day one. He pretty much told Westbrook, you need to go back to wherever you came from, as if he was like some sort of slave or some shit.
So that was a tweet.
Go back to where you came from. That was okay. A tweet, yeah. And then he got into it. Like, he funny thing about it is, he got into an argument with somebody about the situation. And he dude said, "If that's really you, I'll beat your ass and your wife." Just some random dude on Twitter. And his reply was, "Come at me, nigger boy." So it's like, bro, you did
on
the
Twitter?
Yes.
That's right.
He did the interview and then said, "Come at me, nigger boy." And then that immediately after, that shit got screenshotted, circulated. He deleted his tweets, talked to his attorney, and now he's only speaking to people through his attorney. So this guy's from Utah. He was a police sergeant for fucking 17 years. And it's like, come on, son. Like, this is partially why people say that police reform is needed. And this is why Cap was kneeling.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? So
that's what I'm getting to.
Somebody actually posted something about, you know, why. Like, pretty much this dude is the stereotypical racist. Number one, he had the shit-eating grin. Number two, he suggests a black man was acting a fool, air quotes. Number three, he invokes his female companion's weight and height to demonstrate his innocence or her innocence. So it's like, bro, you are literally breaking down like the racist card, like the innocent guy. You know what I mean? And it's just like, bro, you can't do that. We're not falling for it anymore. So cut the shit.
It's different. It's different levels to this shit for me. Like, because, like, and we had this discussion, what, just last, or 2 weeks ago, about the kid touching Russell Westbrook, to where how the NBA needs to do more things to protect the players. No one should be able to make threatening comments, homophobic, racial comments to any NBA player without repercussion. And I guess in Utah, they was giving out red cards as, like, a warning. So I guess him or some fans around had already received a red card. Like, no, what the fuck is that? Kick them out as soon as you hear that. Like, you know what I mean? No, they should be kicked out the first time you hear them make some type of comment like that. And it sucks that players can't really respond to these fans like they want to without getting suspended or getting fined. So
now,
I think that's bullshit.
Now, Nationwide, what I want to ask you is what is your solution to this problem?
The only solution is kicking them out immediately.
I understand that, but how do you monitor that? Like you say, kick them out immediately, but like, do you want to have cameras? Do you want to have people in the audience? Like, what are you thinking?
Well, they already have security guards guarding the bench.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
They have mad security guards, mad police at the game.
Right, but I'm saying, like, you know, the security guards normally by the bench. Therefore, if somebody says something or a group of people say something, it's hard to figure out who says what. So I'm saying, like, well, do you think they need somebody like a fan, a secret fan sitting amongst everybody every game?
I'm pretty sure they got that already.
Yeah. I don't know that they have that.
Or microphones per seat. Like, you know what I'm saying?
I think it's going to be hard for a fan to monitor that. But I do believe that between the security guards that they have at the games and the police officer, they should be walking around these, you know, just kind of monitoring the seats, monitoring what's going on.
But 100%, Nate, you know, there ain't nobody going to say shit, and you sitting right in the,
right.
And the police right there in front
right.
of you.
Know
as soon
mean?
As you walk away, he's, you know, he says whatever he says.
Well, I mean, I understand it, but I don't know if you can have just a secret. I don't know But bottom line is, if that shit is heard, that they should be kicked out immediately. It should never be a situation to where we're giving you a warning card.
But the thing about it is that you can't get a warning card if you're yelling things at players that aren't necessarily racist or obscene. Like, you're like, you know what I'm saying? Like, just, you can be talking shit without cussing. You know what I'm saying?
I'm fine with fans talking shit.
But what I'm saying is that if it gets to a point where you're like, yo, like, you need to chill out a little bit. Like, you can be over-aggressive without being necessarily disrespectful. And you can get a warning card. You know what I'm saying? So, I'm not necessarily... I don't think the red card thing is necessarily a bad thing. Because, like, if you're, like... I don't know. What can you say to a player that's not, like, overly disrespectful? Like, calling them the N-word. You could be, like... I don't know. Sell the team. You know what I'm saying? It's like, bro, you need to chill. You know what I'm saying? It's like a you need to chill moment. And then you get your card, and you get caught doing that shit again. Then you Audi 5000. So it's like, I don't know exactly the solution, but
I think that's it, though. I agree. I get what you're saying. Like, you can't talk so much shit to a player to at some point they respond, and the red card may be cool as a warning. However, if it's something to where it's racial, homophobic, fuck that red card. You should be kicked out immediately.
Nate.
I hear what you're saying on the kicked out immediately, but we live in a capitalist society. So
you think the fans won't replace him?
So a ticket that sold for $50K, you think I don't want his money again?
You think someone wouldn't buy that ticket?
Somebody will, but I'm just saying, you think he won't buy it again? Like, if I can get his money again.
Well, when they say ban for life, there's no way to monitor who's coming in and out your arena.
Shit, why ain't it?
There's no way for you to monitor who's coming in and out your arena. Like, there's not a way.
Yeah,
They're not checking fucking IDs at the games. They don't have a fucking iPad in their phone to monitor who's coming in and out the arena. When they say ban for life, like, he will no longer ever be able to, like, purchase a season ticket. Like, if I could go on like, when we went to the fucking Ohio State game, they didn't check shit. They barely pat you down.
You been to a Cavs game?
No, I haven't been to a Cavs
game. They checking IDs when you walk through. Because, they don't want you bringing weapons. So, you got to go through a whole little kind of – I call it a fake TSA.
That's interesting. I wasn't aware of that. But I've been to a Bengals game. They didn't check nothing. But I don't think I got pat down at the Bengals game.
They ain't check shit at the Bengals game.
You know what I'm saying? So,
but realistically, though, I like the red card idea because, you know – To his point, I'm sitting with Meech being unruly. They hear him, but they see me. So I don't want to be the one kicked out immediately.
But
you know what I'm saying? So
in that
car,
situation,
so
you would tell.
Huh?
In that situation, you would tell. Like, no,
I can't, guarantee I will. I will tell. But you'll say it wasn't me. You wouldn't be like, it's him. You wouldn't point at Meech.
Yes, you would. I mean, Meech is your boy, so
that's my point. Okay, that's my point. Okay. That's my point.
Oh, no. In that situation, nah.
Goddamn, 6'9". 6'9". Right. But
24, C6. He did that shit.
But then if you got a red card, then security knows where they need to shift their attention because you're really only monitoring the lower-level seats.
Yeah, that's all
you're
monitoring.
You're really
people
only monitoring
the
lower-level seats. But you can't control everybody's actions. But if you start handing out shit like that, and players got to start getting the benefit of the doubt. I think when this Russell Westbrook shit popped up, almost immediately everybody's like, Russ need to be the bigger man. Russ need to do this. Russ need to do that. And it's like, we don't know what these fans are saying to him and how often they're saying it to him, how many times he's ignored it before he finally responded. It's just almost immediately, you're the player, you're the millionaire, you should shut up.
But here's,
you know what I'm saying?
Right, but here's the problem with the red card when it comes to those type of comments. I don't think that should be zero tolerance when it comes to homophobic,
absolutely.
Like shit like that. That it should be zero tolerance. And if it's not, okay, I got
but
a red card. All I
do
did
you
was
know
get a warning.
Hard,
the next person can do the same thing.
Do you know how hard it is to single out who said what, bruh, in a loud-ass arena? And it's like, you got one person like, boo, you got next person like, fuck you. You got next person like, you
I don't
nigger.
Think it's that hard.
You crazy, bro.
Like
it's lower level.
At the lower level, I don't think it's that hard. Bro. Like, obviously,
but again,
obviously
you're trying to give somebody a chance and yourself to say, I'm not about to ban 50K. You know what I'm saying? I just really feel like these owners.
The owners ain't losing. Bro, the owners are not going to lose out on that money.
They may not.
That seat
they
ain't
may
going
not.
Empty.
But if you can spend 50K, what else can I get you to buy? You know what I'm saying?
That seat ain't going empty.
What else can I get you to buy? So I'm going to give you multiple chances before I lose your $50K for this seat.
I mean,
and other shit that you may purchase.
I get it when it comes to
If you pay $50 for one, you know what I mean?
When it comes to regular trash talk. I have no problem with fans just talking trash to players. That's part of a
home
court
advantage.
I'm not
saying you're wrong. I'm talking about, ain't none of these owners black. You know what I'm saying? So I think it's a capitalist society, so they're looking at that money. Yeah, you got some hatred spewed at you, but this person just paid this, and they bought seven of them. You know what I'm saying? And am I about to lose $750K a seat tickets because you upset? And that's just the real life that I believe that they're how they look at it. Because as this guy didn't have those tweets, I don't know if we're still having these conversations.
But, I mean, he wasn't in no 50,000 seats either. Like, that 50,000 seat in front row.
I'm just saying.
And that's easy to point out in that case. You know what I mean?
He was close enough, though.
No,
I don't think his seat was 50.
No, hell no. But when it comes to that, it should be zero tolerance. And like, just like the point to where it's the first five or six rows to where players can hear, I don't think it would be hard for people to monitor that, the security guards, police, if you're kind of walking back.
Because the players point them out anyway.
Yeah, like, you know what I mean? You hear the shit. But when I say it's level, speaking to your other point that you made, this guy was a police sergeant. Like, so here, when people say racism doesn't exist, black people making this shit up, police brutality ain't real, they just doing their job. Bro, this is a perfect example of a guy that was racist, or that is racist, that was on your police force. So you mean to tell me he probably didn't charge?
Put on the blue uniform to invoke his power.
Invoke his power, you know what I mean? That's the scary part of it. Yeah, exactly. That's the scary part about it. And that's the bullshit. Like, even bigger than the Russell Westbrook situation, that's the bullshit that bothered me even more, because you know he got boys on a police force, and you know he ain't the only one who feel that way. So I think that's some bullshit.
And the crazy thing about it's going to sound – I'm just not pro like black, and it's like fuck all the white people. It's like, bro, that shit happens everywhere.
You ain't pro black?
I'm saying just
pro black don't mean fuck all white people.
I'm saying I'm not just pro black.
Okay.
And saying fuck all white people. But it's just like in any aspect in life, bro, like you could literally be like, you know, like that. Like, say if I worked at a credit card company, bro, it's like I'm never waiving the late fee for a white person. You could hear the voice. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, that could be one thing. Or like, you hiring people as a manager. I ain't never hiring no white people. You know what I'm saying? Or black people. It's like, it's just crazy, like, how there's always going to be that small window of power that you can't even, like, question, because you could try to wiggle out of it. Like, oh, he wasn't qualified. You know what I'm saying? And it's just fucked up, man. Same thing with women. Like, I'm not hiring no women to fucking file my reports. Like, what?
And here's the thing about that. Because there's definitely different levels to this shit.
Oh, it's 100. It's way different
people
levels.
People can abuse their powers and you know, their privileges in so many different ways. And I thought about this. Like, at some point, to where, like, in some situations, it may not necessarily always be racism. Or it could just be nepotism. You know what I mean? To where it's like, I'm going to look out for my people. Like, and
absolutely.
Like, and is it, obviously, that's wrong, because
I mean, there's some situations that are not racism. Netflix and Monique, I don't think that's racism.
No, hell no, that's not racism. And even for my, like, I don't think people really talked about racism versus being sexism.
I don't even think it was that. Yeah,
like, yeah, because it's like, Monique, you're not hot right now. Sorry. But is nepotism wrong? Because it's like, if we start a black business, 9 times out of 10, you're going to look out for black people. I mean, just to be real. Now, it's going to be certain roles within the company to where it's like, I want the best qualified candidate because he a leader or whatever. But for the most part, it's like, I'm going to look out for my people.
But what's crazy, though, is that in that same breath, bro, black people go off, bro. Like, they won't hire no black people. I heard that shit over and over again in my life, bro. You know what I'm saying?
No, for facts. Yeah.
100%. And it's just like, but then you think about the exact same thing as far as, like, flips the script. It's like, black people be like, I bought this black Benson. All I'm hiring is black people.
Yeah, so it's just like between nepotism and racism, how do you separate the two? Like, I don't know. That's a deeper question that, I mean, we ain't really thought about. Well, if I don't think we're ready to discuss it.
I think with nepotism, if you're in a corporation, then it's, you got equal opportunity employment laws you got to abide by. So nepotism,
man, yeah, falls but into no. That. Like, yeah. All that comes down to is you got to interview their ass.
No, not necessarily. You just can't. If my brother is a CEO, if I'm not qualified, I can't. He just can't bring me on to be a VP.
I know, but I'm saying is that, like, you still have to. All I'm saying is those equal opportunity things means that you have to interview them. But
I'm saying the reason why it falls. The reason why I brought it up is because even if you do nepotism, say if my brother interviews me and he picks me. If somebody says, hey, I believe this is a case of nepotism, then that's a case open against that organization that did that, and they have to defend it.
Right.
So that's the thing to where, yeah, I can do it, but am I prepared to go through the legalities of defending the choice I made type of thing? If you are, then just you do what you want.
And then another crazy thing, it's like between nepotism and racism will come. I think if you are a corporation, they track those numbers, especially if you're like a public company, to where if your workforce is –
not diverse.
Then they can make that argument. Whereas if you're a small business, it's like, hey, I'm a small business. I hired people who came to apply for my job, and that's the people of the community. So but I think it's different.
At the end of the day, I'm not against nepotism, though. Like, I think if it's abused, yeah. But, I mean, nepotism, I'm not against it because the way that – I want to say we're taught, we all talk, get it out the mud, and pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. It's our mentality we have. But when you get out in the world and see that everybody else is doing nepotism, you kind of change your stance on it. It's like, oh, I'm looking at my crew and like, y'all got to get y'all's because I can't bring you on because I know you, but everybody else on because they know them. Yeah. So it's like, man, oh, hell no. I'm going to play the same game, you know, type of thing.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, like, it's like, you just trying to equal the playing field, you know what I'm saying? And then you get caught up doing that, and everybody is doing that exact same thing. Like, I'm only doing it because he did it, or they did it, or you know what I mean? So you just wish that you could just hit a reset button and everybody, like, does it the right way as, like, the best person that's available. So that all goes back to it ain't about what you know, it's who you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but back to the point, fuck Shane Keith.
Yeah, fuck him. Nationwide.
And his wife.
Do you agree with this
statement? Oh, and before you go there, Russ, you shouldn't have said that about the wife. So I will say
that. I didn't take him literally that he was actually going to fuck
still,
up.
I mean, right. I don't. Now, hopefully no one took him literally. But still, that's not something you want to say, especially in today's climate.
Now, this could be taken the wrong way, too. We're all taught if a woman put her hands on you, walk away. If a woman is abusing you, walk away. Don't hit her back. But if it's a verbal onslaught, if she's arguing with you, do you not have the right as a man to at least argue back? Why don't you have the freedom to argue back?
Well, let's
if you get verbally assaulted, can I return another?
Let's pause this.
Yeah.
Let's rewind a little bit. I don't think as a man you should have to walk away either. If you make the attempt to walk away and she continues to follow you and hit you, then at some point you got to right to defend
yourself. I don't think you should swing back.
No, you shouldn't swing. I agree. I don't think you should like strike a woman, punch her in the face, hey, but bro, you should be able to do whatever you need to do to defend yourself. If you attempt to walk away and she continues, because like
unless she has a weapon. If she got a weapon,
that's
totally
different story. You
got to kind of go handle business.
But we've seen situations to where, or videos, whatever, to where a guy is walking away. He's not trying to, you know, put his hands on a female.
Bro, Brittany Griner pull up on you with them hands. I'm giving her everything I got. Straight up. I don't go for what y'all talking about.
I'm going to definitely try to avoid the hands until I can't avoid the hands.
Yeah. You have to avoid it at all costs, in my opinion. But like, I don't think women should just have the right to just hit a man without.
But that same type of thing is now on arguments. Like it was, she became a defenseless victim woman because he yelled at her. Yeah. He yelled at her. He was yelling at him about his wife.
Nah, we can exchange words. Yeah. We can exchange words for 100%.
At the end of the day, bro, we don't know what she said. She may have been the end bomb dropper.
That's my point.
You just never know. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? So
that's why I can't completely say Russ was wrong by yelling at her. Like, we don't know what she was saying.
Exactly. So, I mean, at the end of the day, Russ, like, if she was wrong, she was wrong. He said what he said. And it may have been valid. You know what I mean? Like, maybe she was like, I'll beat your ass. And he was like, I'll beat your ass. You know what I mean? So, at the end of the day, she'd get her ass beat straight up. I don't care what y'all talking about. If a woman is out here throwing hands at me, she gonna catch a few till she's done.
All right, so Meta World Peace.
No.
Meta World Peace.
Nah, bro. Nah. I don't care, bro. No.
No, I agree with you, but we're being toxic right now.
What I'm saying
right
is that you defend yourself until the not the opponent, but the threat. Until the threat is neutralized, bro.
He came an opponent. Hey.
Hey, you stop the threat till it's neutralized. I don't care if it's a woman, a man,
Super Bowl
or a dog.
54.
Right.
Straight up, bro.
Right. What's his name? Giles versus fucking fight. All right.
Cartier versus Jane Doe 4.
Right. All right. Meta World Peace. I'm just going to ask you this question and we can wrap it on up. Meta World Peace just put out a tweet, and this guy's funny. All right, so he says, at King James is definitely the MVP this year.
Wrong.
It showed how when he got hurt, the team really was affected. Best player in the world. Maybe in a couple years he will slow down, but not right now, hashtag Blaze Pizza.
Wrong, wrong. Everything about that statement was wrong. Like, we got worse when he came fucking back.
If Zoe and King James was healthy, Lakers would have still been in fourth place.
I mean, and
hashtag Blaze.
I mean, that could be true, but that shit didn't happen. We got worse when he came back. He's not the best player this season. I will say that he hasn't been the best player. I think James Harden, Giannis, and PG's having better years than he is.
So if he's not the best player, who is his opponent?
Fuck you.
Oh, yeah. So yeah, everything about that statement is wrong in my opinion.
Gotcha. Cartier, you got anything else for us before I cut the music on?
Hold on. I mean, we didn't touch on OBJ or
oh,
or
my bad. Like, damn, we got a while ago. OBJ.
Or Le'Veon.
No, I don't fuck Le'Veon.
Well, no.
OBJ.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't even talk about it real quick. I mean, OBJ, bro, the Cleveland, bro. All I'm saying is that I see how the game.
Yeah, I'm definitely up in there. This is going to be exciting because these personalities is about to be great to watch. Baker, Jarvis, OBJ. Yeah. I mean, the biggest concern is that they got a coach that hasn't had a real full season, right?
As a head coach.
Yeah. So
he's never been a head coach. This is his first head coaching job.
He's the one that has his hands full with trying to really cater to everybody's needs that's on the offensive end of the ball.
I mean, I love the number of weapons that they have there. On paper, this is going to be a dynamic offense with OBJ. Juice.
I didn't watch much of the Browns, but from what I'm reading, Jarvis is more middle of the field guy.
Yeah, he's a possession.
OBJ's receiver. Deep threat. Okay.
Yep. So, I mean, they're a perfect 1-2 punch together. They have Njoku, the tight end, who is going to ball out in the middle of the
field.
They
have who?
Njoku, the tight end.
Oh, man, the M'Baku tribe.
Right.
Over the past year, he started to come along, and you could see his game developing. You had Chubb, who had a huge year once they finally allowed him to be the starting running back, and then at some point they're going to Kareem Hunt back. They have a nice young defense. I mean, I'm excited for Cleveland.
The coach is the one that has the
biggest stress right now.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
The coach is immediately on the hot seat. Yeah. Like, because Dorsey, like, we've seen Cleveland be a laughingstock in the NFL. They haven't did shit since they've been back in the NFL. I don't think they made a playoff since they've come back. They've gone through, 24, 25 running backs. I mean, quarterbacks, sorry. 8, 9 head coaches, 7, 8 GMs. So they have literally been a laughingstock, but Dorsey has come in, stabilized the franchise, made a lot of big moves, and, you know, they're the favorite to win the division now. And I'm excited for Cleveland fans to, like, go into the year with excitement and, you know, with expectations.
All right. So, if you're the Giants, how are you feeling? I see a lot of Giants lost this trade, but
Giants lost this trade.
All right. So, they got a first-round pick, right?
Third, and Jabril Peppers.
So, you got a first-round pick, and with the Browns, that is a starting player that they picking. with the first, in the first round.
It's going to be pick 17. Yeah, everyone, in my opinion, every player you pick in the first round should be someone that should start or contribute.
So
right
it
away.
Depends on how they use that 17th
right,
pick
right.
then.
Yeah, if they draft the bus, they definitely lost this trade. You know what I mean? I mean, they had to find somebody with that first round that can make an immediate impact.
But was OBJ really a problem there, or was it just like – get Eli out and he'd be good.
I think they made OBJ the problem. Like,
yeah, he was a scapegoat. What I'm saying,
yeah, scapegoat. Clearly, Eli is done.
Yeah, right.
And
right.
I talked about that earlier. Like, you could continue to commit to a quarterback that hasn't done nothing over the past 5 or 6 years. And I hate that about football, because football is a what have you done for me lately?
Yeah.
Lead for every position except the quarterback, especially if the quarterback did win some in the past.
Now I'm sitting back watching this. And everybody can't subscribe to the Patriots model of not getting a big time receiver. But how come the Packers ain't getting like Aaron Rodgers any type of weapons?
Because like, don't nobody like him, bro. He an arrogant.
And I'm just watching back looking at this shit. And I'm like, nobody's ever going to Green Bay.
But when you think about it, no one ever goes to Green Bay. They typically build their team through the draft. They never really sign big time free agents.
They lose them, huh?
Just over the last, 5 or 6 years, the only free agent, like, big name that I can remember them signing was Julius Peppers. Like, they typically don't go the free agency route, and they build through the draft.
So, if you Aaron Rodgers, are you going to the front office and, like,
no,
get
yeah,
out of there?
I'm pretty sure he's complaining, like, man, get me a receiver. And there was the rumors that they may be, you know, looking into AB. That never came to fruition or whatever. But, I think they need to get him some weapons, because otherwise you're wasting them.
Yeah. He going to just be discount double check out the playoffs every goddamn year.
Discount his ass.
But, yeah, I like the Cleveland moves. I think the Giants lost a trade for sure. And the reason why I say they lost a trade is because you're giving up a top receiver in his prime. And, like, if you're going to draft a Haskins as your quarterback, why not keep a dynamic superstar receiver for him?
So, do you now feel like they're not going to draft Haskins? Well, I just had an alert just pop up that said they want Rosen from the Cardinals.
They're going to trade for Rosen. Rosen's going to do his 8-game to 16-game internship. They're going to send Eli off with his nice little goodbye package, and then they're going to move forward. And they're just going to be shitty next year. They're going to be shitty the year following. Saquon Barkley's going to be very upset. His contract will be up. They're going to probably throw a tag on his ass, so he'll be there for at least 3 more years. And, the fourth year they may re-tag his ass, and then he's going to hold out like Le'Veon. Le'Veon's going to be old and retired and broken up. His knee's going to be tired. And OBJ going to win the Super Bowl with the Browns.
And speaking of Le'Veon, man, he lost. Like, in my opinion, I'm sorry. Like, I understand you got more guaranteed money on this contract. However, you turned down a 5-year $70 million contract with the Steelers.
19 was guaranteed, cuz. I don't want to hear that shit.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I'm getting to. So, 19 of that contract was guaranteed.
19.
I understand it was an injury.
5 years, 19, bro. Average that out.
Okay, it's $15 million a year. Or, sorry, $14 million a year on that contract. 5 years, $70
million. No. Guaranteed money, bro. Don't give me the incentives.
Okay. No, 5 years, $70 million. That's not even including incentives. So, 19 of it is guaranteed. As long as he didn't get hurt, it was an injury risk with that contract. But assuming he didn't get hurt, he would have made that 35 guaranteed in the first 2 years.
No, but the thing about it is that, bruh, only God knew if he was going to get hurt, bro. I don't want to hear it.
Man, like I said,
I
understand
it's a cutthroat
injury
game,
risk.
Bro. It's a cutthroat game.
There's an injury
and
risk.
You're running back.
And even if people that got injured,
they
want to cut him. They
should
want to
check this out,
bro.
Listen, do you understand how much Mark Ingram just got average a year? Mark Ingram.
5 minutes.
Mark Ingram five isn't great. He's not great. But think about it. If Le'Veon Bell gets hurt,
They wouldn't have cut Le'Veon Bell. If he would have tore his ACL, they wouldn't
have cut
him.
What I'm saying, though, injured Le'Veon equals Mark Ingram. And that's $5 million, bro.
Fuck out of here.
No. What are y'all saying?
He better than Mark Ingram on this worst day.
Bruh. Y'all discount Mark Ingram like he wasn't all right.
No, he's good, but he's not
Le'Veon Bell. Right.
Bro, but listen, bro. The running back market is the worst market. So if you're going to hold out.
Right now,
if you're going to hold.
Now.
No, it's not coming.
It is coming up right
no,
now.
No, man, fuck out of here. If you're a player and you're at a position, running back is the one position you should hold out. Slot receivers are getting more than running backs now. Slot receivers getting $10 million a year, bro.
Listen, he held out.
Patriots win the Super Bowl?
He held out to try to reset the running back market.
Five wide.
He tried to reset the running back market, and he didn't do that. He got less than what the Steelers was offering. You left $14.5 million on the table by holding out.
But that was for 1 year, hoping that he don't get hurt.
But that was on a franchise tag. You didn't have to take. You could have took the long term deal. They wasn't even if he would have got hurt, they wasn't going to cut him after year
but
one.
But you don't know that, bro. They you don't know that. But you don't know. That's what I'm saying. You're just assuming, like nigga. Odell Beckham signed a fucking 7-year deal and got traded.
He got traded. Getting traded is different from getting cut. I know, but you don't get your money. Traded, I still under contract.
I know, but at the end of the day, nothing's for sure is what I'm saying, bro. They literally said the other day, we didn't sign Odell Beckham to trade him. What the fuck is wrong with y'all? Then they traded the nigga.
I mean, I understand that, but they wasn't.
Think about them old white motherfuckers.
You're not
going to
cut a top
them.
Running back because he got hurt.
Man, nah. If
that's
if,
still in the prime of his career, I can see if he's like 31.
You act like AB didn't just get traded in the prime of his career. Come on, bro.
No, but AB wanted that trade. That's different.
It don't matter. Le'Veon Bell didn't want to be there. Nothing's guaranteed in the NFL. You should know that. So therefore, if he can get his guaranteed money and if he ball out next year,
he only got 35.
Only 35, bro. The difference between 16 and 35 for your life if you don't get paid no more money is huge. Huge.
But how much money did he leave on the table?
It don't matter. You don't know what he left.
He could have 14. He could have 14 and 17 million.
He could have left the difference between 34 and 16.
Nah.
If he got hurt,
I ain't buying it,
bro. What's your boy's name with the South Carolina? Lattimore?
Yeah.
Yeah, knee tore the fuck up. He broke his fuck. Somewhere dirty as fuck right now. Them
damn,
straight
why
backs.
Gotta be all that?
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Why gotta be all that? Because he is that. You know what I'm saying?
Shit.
He could have been that bum ass nigga that went to Rutgers. That's on LeBron James shit. You know what I'm saying? You just never know where life can take you. He guaranteed 34 instead of 16. So get off his back.
He lost.
Man, he lose. Nigga, he 34
he's
up.
He's making 13.
He 34 more up than both of us. So, chill.
He
lost lose.
In his deal.
He
and,
lose.
And the funny thing about it, there was
I don't think he lost financially.
He lose.
He may have lost being on a competitive team.
He lost in his deal. He didn't accomplish his goal by resetting the market, getting 16 to 17
You don't know what his
year.
Goal was.
He didn't accomplish his goal.
You don't know
and
what his goal was.
And it's funny thing about it, a Jets fan tweeted him like last year.
Yeah, said,
like,
we'll pay you $60 million
cash. You should come run with the Jets.
And he signed
for 54. 4 years, $60 million. $60 million ain't enough for me to run. You just signed a contract less than what he was talking about.
Of course, though, but that's what he gonna say in the moment.
Bro, he lost. Because
he was
trying
to flip the market. But at the end of the day,
he lost.
He got his guaranteed bread, bro.
Like,
I don't.
But he got that bread from Pittsburgh. He got a better offer from Pittsburgh.
But nationwide, he got 35, and then he can get up to 54, which nobody ever makes it to the max. Like, ever. Nobody, bro. Nobody makes it to the max.
Okay, but what I'm saying, if he was on Pittsburgh roster for 2 years, he would have got that 34.
But the thing about it is that he could have got hurt within those 32 games, bro. Chill with that shit. Niggas,
I don't understand the loss financially
ACLs.
Part of it.
Huh? They tear their ACLs in practice.
Because he lost, like, he held out. He didn't play last year.
I get it. I don't understand how you think that he's losing by getting 35 guaranteed versus one worth. If I don't play a snap, right? If I go out there and I play one snap and I don't play anymore, I get 35. You want me to play 2 years to get that 35. So that's more taxing on the body to get what I'm getting for one snap. That's the part I don't understand why you call that a loss.
He lost. Guaranteed. Like, okay, you're talking about the guaranteed money. Guaranteed is 34. He can go out and fucking tear his ACL. That's all you're getting is 34.
That's fine.
Like, when you're speaking from an injury standpoint.
But nationwide.
If he stayed healthy, what I'm speaking from, all he's going to get is 52.
But Nate.
If he stayed healthy with Pittsburgh, he's getting 70.
But Nate.
You're losing fucking money.
But listen, Nate. Listen to this real quick. If he would have had to stay healthy for 32 games, roughly, to actually make that whatever.
No, he just would need to stay healthy through the first year and be on the roster the second year, and then that money
exactly.
would have kicked in.
So, okay, 32 fucking games, pretty much. I'm saying max, like healthy, okay, versus 1 minute, one snap, bro. Like, you got to think about that. And he already up. He got millions already. So it's like,
he
bro,
never really made big money.
Oh, that's even worse.
He never really made big
money. If you broke as fuck, and you talking about, bro, you know how fast you can run through $16 million, bro, in 16 years? I could spend $1 million a year, especially if you already living lavishly.
But I understand y'all speaking from an injury risk. Take the injury risk out of it. He lost fucking money.
No, I don't think it's an injury risk. I think Cartier is speaking from the aspect of, all right, I can $70 million, you said it, right? 70 with,
yes,
Pittsburgh.
70 with Pittsburgh.
I think Le'Veon was probably weighing, will I actually get to that $70 million?
He would have gotten to that $70 million as long as he did.
Let's go here, Nate.
What if there was a decline in play and they don't honor the contract?
Do you really think his game was going to decline?
But no, it's not about whether I think it's going to decline. I think that's the options that you're weighing. Like, okay, I can maximize my salary now.
At what point do you think his game would have declined?
It could have, bro.
At what point do you think his game would
have
declined?
If his line was trash ass,
at what point do you think his game would have declined?
Usage in offense, for sure.
It depends on his offense. He's dependent on his linemen. If his linemen are trash, he looks trash. But, okay,
Pittsburgh has had a prolific offense for the past 5 years. At what point, in what year do you think his game would have declined?
Next year. It can definitely decline.
He hasn't
played a snap of football last year, Nate. So I can't guarantee that he's gonna step on the field and still be a great back.
No, I'm saying if he was playing last year,
Nate. Let me ask you this, Nate. What's the difference between $100 million and $70 million?
$30 million. That's a big difference.
But I'm talking about like as far as like if somebody gave you $70 million, they gave you $100 million, and you was like everyday Nate, like are you tripping? Like literally right now, like are you like, bro? I want, like, is you losing your mind over that $30 million? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I would.
Nah, come on, man.
I would definitely take the $100 million. I mean,
of course you would, like, take it, but I'm saying like,
$100 million. Okay, if you
ask what me more can you do with a 170?
A lot. Like generational wealth.
Like what?
Generational wealth.
How many generations? Like what? Three or four?
Forever.
Two.
100. That extra $30 million is gonna change my life.
Okay.
Family forever.
But what family? Like.
My kids. My fucking lifeline.
Okay, but look, though. All right, so look. I'm telling you this. The difference between $70 million and $100 million is way less drastic than zero and 32.
I mean, I don't think Le'Veon is losing any sleep because at the end of the day, he's still a millionaire. He got his money.
You just want him to play the long game.
So I don't think he's losing any sleep, but he lost on his goals. I don't think he accomplished his ultimate goals because he didn't accomplish what he set out.
That's
which
your
was getting $16-17 million
his
a year.
Goal was. But what I'm saying is that is if, like, you have to live in reality, bruh. You can't depend on your knees and your body. Think about how many body parts that he could have broke. All right, he has knees, he has ankles, he has arms, he has fingers. He has a fucking concussion. CTE is real.
I don't give a fuck about none of the injuries outside of knee injuries.
No,
fuck a concussion. Fuck a broken finger.
What do you mean?
You're not getting cut for a broken finger. Bro. Unless he blow out his knee, unless whatever happened.
How long is his deal with the Jets, by the way?
It's a 4-year, $52 million.
Gotcha.
Okay,
like,
but look,
35
Nate,
is guaranteed.
What I'm saying, though, Nate, listen, bro. If you sit out 1 year, you're guaranteed $32 million. Then you can actually go perform. And if you're good for 2 years, then you're good for a next contract, and then you're up to hundreds of millions.
No more big contracts.
No, but listen, you don't know that. But what I'm saying though is, look, he's sitting on 32 guaranteed, but there's a chance that if he goes out and plays, he gets his 14 or 16 he was getting from the first year, and then it might be over, bro. You didn't know.
Or
like,
Nate,
there's a chance that it might be over. Therefore, he's sitting on 16 only, but
or if he go and ball out like you say, there's always a restructure. Like, yo, I want more. In the 52.
Exactly.
So now you're holding out again and
no, and not holding out again.
You got your 35. So let's go through the whole process.
You're going through the whole process again.
Exactly. But the thing about it, Nate, is you can't live. I don't feel like you should live in the moment of I'm guaranteed perfect health or enough health to get to the 70. Like, nobody gets to the 70, bruh. Think about when's the last run? Barry Sanders retired because he knew he wasn't getting to the 70.
Nah, he retired because they just won't win.
Whatever, but I'm just saying. Like, and Ray Rice, bruh.
He knocked out a chick.
He injured his way out the league.
He knocked out someone.
No, he that happened, but his injuries didn't help. So it's just like, bruh, you just never know. And Le'Veon already had drug problems. So it's like, bruh. If already fucking I'm a weed head, already got suspended 2 times in 2 years, and I'm guaranteed $32 million if I sit out this year, bro, I'm giving me my 32. You can't argue with that, bro.
Leave it alone, Nate.
I'm gonna leave it alone. At the end of the day, his bank account ain't as sitting as nicely as it would with Pittsburgh.
It's sitting better than the Norris.
Go ahead.
32 up.
Facts.
When's the draft?
April 20th.
Yeah, we'll be arguing about the draft. As always, man, I appreciate all of y'all for tuning in. Y'all gave us an excellent week last week. Please give us another excellent week this week. man, it's been truly a blessing. There will not be a show next Wednesday. We are on episode 100, so we'll be recording that episode on Saturday, I believe, and putting it out for ITL Church on Sunday. but I go by the name Johnny Will. I'm signing out.
Yo, this is Nationwide. I'm out.
Cartier King, man, I definitely appreciate y'all listening. Definitely keep listening because I got a lot to say.
Run it back.
All right, so we got a pop-up shop this weekend at Sheik's on Salem Avenue. It starts at 5 p.m. until pretty much come out, wear your green, man, pull up. It's a St. Patrick's Day pop-up slash party. Open bar, they got food. It's going to be a nice turnout, man. It's going to be all love. We got all exclusives. You know what I'm saying? If you got them Do It, Dream It, Nines, pull up. We got exclusive for that. You have a Nike day, we got exclusives for that. Anything that you could think of, we got exclusive one-on-ones that I can't even tell you about. So many of them. But we definitely going to put a preview up Saturday morning, Friday night. So be looking forward to that at King Meech DYT, at Legendary Ave Clothing. Can't wait to see y'all. ITL out.